Christian are powerful servants. Now, this is the time in the hour that we need more prayer in our churches or in the family. I want to cite to you some of the examples in the Old Testament. I'll just read to you, and then we'll apply it in the context of the countries of the world today. We'll see it in the book of Nehemiah, and we'll see it in the book of Daniel, and we'll learn from these people what are the criteria, so what are the elements that are included in their prayer that God answered them right away. We'll be reading it in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 3 to verse 5. Something happened with the nation of Israel, especially Jerusalem. They have no identity, and there was a man who stood up in the test of time. His name is Nehemiah, the cupbearer, the king. Now, something happened. There was a report that he received, and this is now the sequence of the story of chapter 9. This is chapter 1. So this is chapter 1, okay? The book of Nehemiah. Okay, sorry for that. Anyway, what happened is there was a report, I read to you quickly, in the book of Nehemiah, and that is the book of Daniel chapter 9. Okay, this. That's Daniel chapter 9 that you cite there. What happened here is that, I read to you chapter 1. Yeah. In verse 3, one time, this Nehemiah asked one of the servants, one of the Jewish people, and he said, one of my brothers came from Judah with some other men and questioned them about the Jewish remnant that have survived the exile and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, those who survived the exile are back in the province, are in great trouble in disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, here is Nehemiah, I sat down, first thing that he did, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of the heaven. Lord, the God of the heaven, this is the prayer, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant. Is praying before you day and night for your servants and the people of Israel. I confess the sins. First, he confessed the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and the laws you gave your servant Moses. And so here is the prayer of Nehemiah praying in behalf of the nation of Israel. In the book of Daniel, chapter 9, that's where we have that. Daniel chapter 9. Okay, thank you. Chapter 9. Begin to read verse 2 there. No? Okay.
From verse 16.
Okay. Okay. Something happened here.
9 to 8.
9 to 8, yeah. Thank you. In the person of the reign, I, Daniel, understood by the books of the number, there's we talk about the 70 weeks, the corresponding suffering and the timetable of the Lord before his son returns, 70 weeks. The books, the number of the years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. There is something is going to happen. Inevitable that will happen to Jerusalem. It will be crushed down to the ground. Then I set my face toward the Lord God to make requests by prayer, another example of prayer, in supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. Three things that are mentioned. Let's continue. And I prayed to the Lord and my God and made confession and said, take note of these phrases and verses, O Lord, great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and with those who keep his commandments. We have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled, even by departing from your precepts and judgment. I think there's a verse there. Can you go back verse 3? Yes. Or verse 2? Verse 3, okay. I set my face and, okay. Here we can see Daniel presented to us concerning the need of the nation of Israel, that they prayed to the Lord, the same thing with Nehemiah. Daniel's prayer was for his nation. The first thing that he read in that chapter 9, you can look it in your Bible. First, he confessed his own sin. Then he used the word, the pronoun we, O Lord, throughout the history of chapter 9. I want you to notice with this man, it was the wickedness and of the people of Israel. It was their wickedness, but Daniel was a man and a prophet of God. I want you to notice, he did not blame anybody. What he did as a man of God, he first accepted the blame and the failure of the whole nation for not following the commandments of God. And then he mentioned about the sinfulness of the nation of Israel. So that was Daniel, Lord, we have committed sin. Lord, I have committed sin. He identified with the sins of the nation of Israel. Daniel and then Nehemiah, the two men of God, we have Moses, we have Jesus people in the Old Testament. We can see both of them identified the sin of the whole nation. And then he used the pronoun we. And thirdly, you can see they humbled themselves before God. They humbled themselves. Both of them fasted. Both of them prayed with complete surrender to God. And both of them humbled themselves to God. A humble and contrite spirit, the Bible says, God will not despise. Those are the three ingredients that they need. They pray with complete surrender to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And they ask God. Nehemiah broke down and wept. And then they quoted the word of God in Daniel 16:19, which you can see there. After they pray, after they humbled themselves, they quoted the promises of God. They have 16 there? Okay, thank you. Oh Lord, they use in prayer, even Nehemiah, they use in prayer the same thing. Take note of that, and God cannot resist the prayer because that was His word. They used the word of God. Oh Lord, according to your righteousness, they quoted that from the Old Testament. According to your righteousness, I pray. Let your anger and your fury be turned away from your city, Jerusalem, your holy mountain. Because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem, and your people are reproached to all those around us. Now therefore, our God, hear the prayer of your servant and supplications, and for the Lord's sake, cause your face to shine in your sanctuary, which is desolated. 18:19. Oh my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolation in the city which is called by your name. For we do not present our supplication before you because of our righteous deeds, but because of your great mercy. That is one of the relative attributes of God. Because of your great mercy from everlasting to everlasting. O Lord, you are heard. Forgive. O Lord, listen and do and act. Do not delay for your own sake, my God. For your city and your people are called in your name. Nehemiah 1:9-11. Okay. And then you'll continue. 9-11. Okay. You saw the affliction of our fathers in Egypt. He quoted the history during the time of Moses. He heard their cry by the Red Sea. Lord, remember that? They cried in their trouble. And you hear their cry in the Red Sea. You show signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his servants, and against all the people of his land. For you knew that they acted proudly against you. So you made a name for yourself as it is today. Now these two great men of God revealed to us the kind of prayer that we are now standing in behalf of the nation of Australia, in behalf of the failure of swords and bombs and things that are happening in the whole world, wide world today. Now, what is now the context of present time that we can pray to the Lord seriously in our family, individually, corporately, in our church? You know, church, this is a real issue that many of you, many of us are well informed. Same-sex marriage, we know that. It's not an easy thing. It is backed up by the political leaders of today. We have Turnbull, we have Bill Shorten, we have the judges, the highest judges of the land, if you follow what's happening, and we have the labor, we have the Greens, we have the marriage equality. In other words, if you see the whole picture of this kind of diabolical attack to the nation of Islam, once it is amended or accepted, there is a great kind of effect for all of us who are believers in the Lord today. Once this thing passed, our children in school will learn, and they'll be obligated to learn because it will become a law. They'll be learned how, they'll learn and understand that same-sex marriage is okay. They will be taught. You cannot resist that because it's become a law. Then our freedom of religion, instead the Word of God, is a code of ethics and conduct. It will be replaced with many other things, and others, the Christian nation will be affected. It's no longer a Bible. We have other books of Hinduism and the Quran and other things. And I want you to hear, we are on the last of all beliefs to be given favored by the Gentile nation or world or government today. We are at the very last. It's not an easy thing. I want you to feel the heaviness of God's heart. And that's how He is looking and counting upon our life today. So we believe that the moment this thing passed, anything that pertains to Christianity, it will be rebutted, no longer in a small court, but in Parliament. Just recently happened in Parliament in Queensland. And I said, oh wow, it's happening in Australia. It's going to be happening in New South Wales and even other places of the world. In Southeast Queensland, about 10 to 12 men and women of God, men of God, doing what they're supposed to do, feeding the poor and the poor, clothing them, giving them some trucks, and a little sermon at 5-10 minutes with their megaphone or some kind of microphone there in a public place. And I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this. They did not do it. They abide the law. They were given permission by the law of the land. They have the permit from the government. And it is a sad reality, Southeast Queensland today, what happened, and they were persecuted, they were treated badly, not only by the people, but by the politicians, and they were persecuted. And what happened to these people there, they were fined tens of thousands of dollars, and thank God there's a parliamentarian there, he stood and explained to them, because they have to get their own attorney because they are sharing Jesus in South Queensland, giving trucks. And one of the men there was addressed as Reverend. It's against the authority to address Reverend because you are sharing some kind of your religion. There is an intensity of attack to Christianity today. We will not be closing our eyes and enjoying and sleeping and things like that. So we have to be awake. Church, I encourage you. Thank God there is still some outreaches in the city. Some of our friends are co-pastor preaching there. And then in Timrin. But it won't be long, as months and just few years from now, we'll be suppressed and squeezed. And eventually we'll be put to jail in the process of time. Because Australia, I told you before, from 1991, we have about 72 to 75% Christian. Just recently, it's from 52 going down. And they are not all committed. They are saying they are believers in Christ. And some are nominal, just a name. If there's a change of a situation, there's a change of happening in our country today. What is the admonition to all of us this morning? Church, it is high time.